In this topic, we will be covering algorithm. This is an example of an algorithm in real life. So consider the following. The problem is to bake a cake. How do we solve this problem of baking a cake? We solve it in a series of steps. Step number one is start. Step number two, preheat the oven at 180 degrees Celsius. Number three, prepare a baking pan. Number four, beat butter with sugar. And number five, number six, etc. until the end where we get our cake and we solve our problem. We can apply a divide and conquer strategy to develop our algorithm. In another problem, where we want to prepare a breakfast, we can summarize it into three main steps. The first step is where we start, the second step is where we prepare the breakfast, and the third step is where we end and we get our breakfast. As you can see, the prepare a breakfast is not as simple as just preparing it. There are a series of steps within this main step. So in preparing a breakfast, there will be three sub-steps. So the first sub-step is to prepare a tuna sandwich. The second sub-step is to prepare some chips. And the third sub-step is to prepare to make a cup of coffee. To prepare a tuna sandwich or to prepare some chips also require further sub-steps or smaller steps. Now to prepare a tuna sandwich, the sub-steps of this main task is to take two slices of bread, and the second step is to prepare the tuna paste. For the second step, to prepare the chips, we need to cut the potatoes into slices as the first sub-step of this prepare some chip step, and then to fry them. And finally, to make the cup of coffee, we need to boil water and add water with sugar and coffee. So this is an example of how we can apply a divide and conquer strategy in preparing the series of steps to solve a problem, also known as, and this series of steps can also be called as algorithm. So what exactly is an algorithm? An algorithm is a specific and step-by-step set of instructions for carrying out a procedure or solving a problem, like what we did before, to bake a cake or to prepare a breakfast. There are usually requirements, and the procedure would start and end at definite or clearly defined points. So there's two types of algorithm representation, or how you can represent or visualize an algorithm, and that is through either a flowchart or a pseudocode. Now, the first way to represent an algorithm is the flowchart. So a flowchart represents an algorithm graphically, and it is used for effective communication and documentation of an algorithm. The figure on the right shows an example of a flowchart of the series of steps, also known as algorithm. These are the basic syntax of a flowchart to denote a start or end to the process. We use the symbol circle, and to denote a process we use a rectangle. Input and output is by this symbol or a parallelogram. When we conduct a test to fulfill a certain condition, we use this diamond shaped symbol, and a smaller circle for a connector if we want to combine different lines of the algorithm, while this arrow shows the direction of the algorithm or the flow of activities. These are other syntax of a flowchart. If we call a function within the algorithm, we use this function call. We use this symbol for a function call. The symbol is for a magnetic disk, while this is for stored data. This is for a document, single document or file, while this is to denote multiple documents or files. So let's look at the simple problem-solving process. We have a process that requires some input to produce our output. So in this example, we want to calculate and display the price of a number of apples if the quantity in kilograms and price per kilogram are given. So the input is the number of apples, or the quantity, and the second input is the price per kilogram of the apples. To calculate the final or actual price for a given amount of quantity of apples, we just need to multiply the quantity with the price per kilogram, and we get our output, or the price. Now, this is a process. A process is usually a mathematical step to produce our output. This is how we represent that problem in a flowchart. There is a definite start and an input, which is the quantity, and another input, which is the price per kilogram. Notice that it is drawn within this parallelogram for both inputs. While the process is whereby we multiply quantity and price per kilogram to get our price is drawn in a rectangle shape box to show that this is a process, or a mathematical process. And once this is done, we get our output, which is also drawn within a parallelogram, which is the price. And since we solve this problem, then we come to an end of the algorithm. There are some guidelines when we develop algorithms to make it easier or more consistent and systematic when trying to solve a problem using algorithm. So first of all, we need to identify the input and outputs of the problem. Now, if necessary, if the problem is complex, then we need to use the divide and conquer strategy, like what we discussed before, to decompose the problem into smaller and more manageable subproblems. So then we decompose the problems until all the subproblems can be solved to get the required results. And for each subproblem, we identify and list out the steps involved in solving it. And in the end, we combine all these these algorithms to solve all these subproblems to become one main algorithm. Now, the second way to approach an algorithm, or to represent an algorithm, is the pseudocode, where pseudo means half, or half a code. Now, a pseudocode is an outline of a program, or script or code, written in a form that can easily be converted into real programming statements. So we write this pseudocode without thinking of the grammar or syntax of the programming language that we will use, and we write it in as much as possible in English so that we can understand the process and the steps. Now, it resembles, notice the key word there, resembles the actual program that will be implemented, or that will be coded later. However, it cannot be compiled nor executed, because again, we are not writing in the syntax or the grammar of the programming language that we will be using. A pseudocode normally codes the following actions. So we would write this as a series of steps. So we need to write this in a pseudocode. The things that we need to write in a pseudocode includes the initialization of variables. Some programming languages require you to initialize the variables, but the ones that we are using this course, like MATLAB or R, doesn't require that. So we just need to define the variables. But again, if you need to initialize the variables, then you should state it out in a sentence or in a step. Number two is to assign the values to the variables. So these two steps of initialization and assignment is not required in MATLAB or other high-level programming languages like Python, MATLAB, and R, because they initialize and define the variables for you in one step. And the third is arithmetic operations, where you go through the process of calculating the values that you need using mathematics. And if required, relational operations that would usually be needed for conditional the control and flow of an algorithm based on some criteria you set, or the criteria that the algorithm needs to proceed. So this is an example of a pseudocode. There's always a start. And in this case, we're not initializing quantity, because assuming that we're using a high-level program language like MATLAB, we just need to define it, which is to read quantity. The third step is to read price per kilogram. The first step is the process where we calculate the price by multiplying quantity and price per kilogram. And the fifth step is to print the price to show the results of the calculation, and finally the end. So in this topic, we covered two types of methods you can use to represent an algorithm. The first step is through a flowchart, and the second way is through a pseudocode.